Hi, this is Bob Kraft of tennisministry.org. I'm the director, and we'd welcome you to come to our website to take a look. Today is going to be a little bit of an interesting topic. It's going to be on Roger Federer, and he is a legend of the game. There's no doubt about that, and I admire him. I've watched him play many times, and I appreciate his game. I'd like to tell you a little bit about my relationship with him. And my whole reason for doing that is, number one, we can pray for Roger and his family. Number two, we can also learn some things from it, from those of you who will have an opportunity to reach players, tennis players for Christ. It gives you an opportunity to kind of think about, well, what would I do, and, you know, what has been done in the past. When I first came on the Pro Tour in the year 2002, Roger Federer wasn't really someone I even knew his name, and I did some checking on the records, and at the Australian Open in 2002, he went out in the fourth round. At the French Open, he didn't play. At the Wimbledon, he was out in the first round, believe it or not, and at the U.S. Open, he was out in the fourth round. So he wasn't a name that I was really that familiar with. Plus, I was just starting full-time on the tour, and I had been part-time for a number of years before, but he wasn't in the tournaments that I was at going back to 97. Now, the players who were at the top at that game, at that year in the game, were people like Leighton Hewitt, Pete Sampras, Thomas Johansson won the Australian Open that year, surprisingly. And, you know, so those were the players that were people that I had my focus on. Now, I started with some of the lower-ranked players in the year 2002, but as I mentioned, Roger wasn't really on my radar screen. He came on very suddenly about 2 or 3 years later, where he started to make the semis, he started to be in the finals, and I think he started to win around that time. At that point, my attention was very much coming on him. Well, you know, we were just hearing his name, and I was surprised, because before that, I hadn't really heard his name much. Now, what was unusual about that was that I was friends with Tony Roach, his coach. Tony Roach had been a former player, top player in the 60s and early 70s, and I got to know Tony by sharing the gospel with him over a period of years, and he was all of a sudden the coach. So that opened a door to Roger Federer that hadn't been open. I was able to sit down at the table with Roger and Tony, and Roger was very much close to Tony, almost kind of like a secondary father, as he would travel with him. He would go to his house and stay over in Australia while he was training, and Tony let me sit at the table with him, and I was able to talk about Jesus Christ totally at that table. Roger was young, he was just on the tour, and I was able to give Tony the daily verse, which I had published at that time, a list of 7 days of verses, and I also gave them to Roger, and that went on for a few years, 2 or 3 years. I gave Roger a New Testament in German, which was had a picture of an athlete on the cover and had personal testimonies, and I remember him looking at it and saying, "Wow, this is great, a Bible in German. Thanks a lot." And he took it and he left. And Tony was working with him coming into the French Open, which I can't remember the exact year, but all of a sudden at Rome, a few tournaments before the French, Tony found out totally unexpectedly that he was no longer going to be Roger's coach. And I had heard that from some friend, mutual friend. And so all of a sudden, Tony was not part of the scene anymore. Now, I had noticed that there started to be a little bit of a separation between him and Roger. You know, whereas before, Roger would always be with Tony almost constantly, all of a sudden, Roger wasn't around, and Tony was by himself, sitting by himself a lot. And but I didn't realize that there was going to be a break in their relationship, their coaching relationship, and probably their friendship, too. So when that happened, that changed a lot for me, because my access was different. As before, I would be able to sit at the table and have total conversation with Roger or Tony. Now it was a different way of approaching things. Roger then brought in some other coaches who I don't believe are Christians, and weren't very supportive. A friend of his and his wife was around, or his girlfriend at that time was around much more, where she hadn't been around much prior. So I was able to say hello. I tried to give him books. I at Wimbledon, when he won his fifth Wimbledon crown, Robert, his father, and I had a nice conversation while Roger was actually playing in the finals. He came out and we had a discussion about his foundation, and I found out that Roger's uncle had been a missionary in Africa. I had heard from another friend of mine, which I wasn't able to verify, that Roger had actually attended a church with a former girlfriend in Switzerland. And these were all kind of clues as to where he was at spiritually. I was able to, during that Wimbledon, talk to Robert, and he was asking me, he was so happy to meet me. And then after Roger won his fifth Wimbledon crown, he came out, he came off the court, and I was with his family, and we were able to have a sip of champagne and celebrate Roger's win. Now, as I said, the relationship for me had changed quite a lot, because before I'd had a lot of direct access, all of a sudden I really didn't. So I was looking at ways to keep that relationship going, which in this case was through his family members. But he had a lot of people around him who really weren't pointing him in a direction of a spiritual life, I felt. So I was also had that to contend with. More things have happened with Roger. You know, he got married, which I was very happy to see. He's had children. His life has changed. He's become a father. I was at the French Open a few years ago. Now, I did make a mistake with Roger, and you know, this is one of the things you learn from, where I was with a friend of mine from Sri Lanka, and the players' lounge was totally full of people. And there were only seats available at Roger's table. Now, Roger was sitting with his then girlfriend and a few other people at a table. And I just asked if I could sit there for a moment because I needed to talk to this person. And his girlfriend said no. Well, I just was offended. So I sat down at those table, at those two chairs, and talked to this man from Sri Lanka for a minute, and the man from Sri Lanka was totally enamored with, I was shocked, with Roger Federer. He was sitting right next to Roger, and all he did was keep turning around looking at Roger Federer and saying, "I'm sitting next to Roger Federer, I'm sitting next to Roger Federer." Well, that was quite embarrassing in many ways, and from that moment on, the door closed with me with Roger and his wife, his girlfriend. She wasn't not very nice to me. I heard different times during Grand Slams. Now, this wasn't related to me, but I saw her. She was yelling, literally yelling, about a reporter being near Roger and screaming, "Get him out of here, get him out of here." So I knew, you know, I had to be very wise about the situation. Last time I was at the Australian a year ago, a similar thing happened. She was screaming and yelling to somebody, "Get him out of here," and I don't know who she was talking about. It could have been me. And, you know, so there was that side of it that I had to be very careful with. And all I could do really was pray. I tried to give Robert, Roger's father, a purpose-driven life book in German, and he didn't receive that well. It took me about 3 or 4 years, really, to get the relationship going back on track, which was just recently in the year 2009, when Roger would walk by me. I think it was mainly because he knew what I did, and he saw consistency in my life. You know, he knows I pray for him, he sees consistency, and he doesn't see a lot of people being offended by me. So I think it was a lot of factors there that brought the relationship back. You know, I had to be very wise, because Roger has a lot of power with tournaments and directors. He's the president of the ATP Council. He's friends with many tournament directors, all tournament directors, and his word has a lot of power. So I had to be very wise. I actually had to not be around him. I could just be friendly to his manager, and who's friendly to me, but otherwise couldn't say much and work on so many other players. And God really told me in my heart that I needed to spend time with other players. There were so many other players I needed to reach for Christ and help in some way, and Roger was just one of them. So it was the many versus the few, that kind of mentality. And then about 2 years ago or a year ago, Roger started to walk by me, and he started to smile at me. Again, he'd shake his head, and it was as if he was acknowledging me. Yeah, it's okay. You know, I can have a relationship with you. And, you know, he'd walk by, he'd say hi, I'd say hi to him, whereas before there wasn't much conversation taking place at all. And, you know, how much of that had to do with him being married and having children and being more stable, I really don't know. But I do know that one thing that you have to learn with what I do, I'm a pastor who's working with tennis players and encouraging them in their faith, is that you have to know when to use your time, when to do certain things and when not to do certain things. And you have to be very patient. So for a number of years, I could do nothing except pray. And now, you know, I had the doors open again. So I'm very thankful about that. And I spent a lot of time off the court with Roger, but I also spent time around him on the courts. Now, I'll end with this kind of story just to kind of help people understand. There were many years where he first came on the tour and he was coming into the French Open or any tournament, and he would, particularly at the French Open, he would lose in the finals, as many of you remember, before he won. And I was always felt that I needed to be there at the end of that, when he came out of the locker room, up the steps, I had to be there to encourage him spiritually and emotionally. And he'd come up, and it would be in the evening time, about 8 p.m. usually, and there would be hardly anybody in that area. They'd all left. The fanfare was over. It would be just himself and maybe his coach and me. And then Nadal would follow, or he'd usually come up before Roger, sometimes after. And I would be there, and I would just talk to Roger. I'd say, Roger, sorry about that. That sometimes that's all you need to say when someone loses a match, just say sorry, and then leave conversation for another day. And I'll remember he said to me, he said, that's all right. He said, there's always next year. You know, so he had that kind of mentality that there's always next year. I can always do it next year. And so I was there year after year in the evening time, and I would wait around 3 or 4 hours with no one around just for that opportunity, for the ability to say two or three words to Roger. And that's how patient you have to be. Another time at the Australian, he won the tournament. I think he went into the press conferences about 1 a.m., and he stayed till 5:30 a.m. This is, again, the tournament's over. There's no more matches going on. And it was just, I was doing the same thing. I was waiting till he came out of the locker rooms. No one's around except his manager and myself. He came out of the locker room, and he and I and his manager, I followed behind them slightly, and he walked to the car, and even there weren't any cars for me, right? So there was just the car for him because all the drivers had gone home. And I walked home in the evening time, which is about maybe a mile. But it was just that opportunity to be there and that he could put in his mind. Well, I saw Pastor Bob. He was the last person I saw at the tournament. And that's important. So I just leave you with those stories, and do pray for him. Continue to lift him up and he and his family in prayer. He's a great champion. He's going to be somebody who's going to be remembered forever in the tennis game. And we'd like nothing more than to see him commit his life to Christ and his family, and make it an important part of his life, and not just tennis is first and church is second. So we'll keep going for him. And God bless you, and I hope you enjoy this conversation. If you'd like to, just check into our website at tennisministry.org, or look at some of our other videos at YouTube/tennisministry. Thanks a lot.